are as he comes to confirm that Muhammad is true. So all the Muslim sources agree with Pastor Joe, exposing our friend Joe as someone, his name was Joe too, right?
Yeah, no, Peter.
Peter, I'm sorry. Exposing Peter is someone either is ignorant about what the Quran says or is being deceptive and is using taqiyya, concealment again. I don't know him personally, so I'll give him the benefit of the doubt and say he was simply ignorant of what his Islamic authority said.
By the way, do you know of any English translation that's commonly out there that starts these verses out with and?
I haven't seen one. I'm going to check here.
James is going to check right now, but you know, the Muslim translators, as we've proved before, are not always very honest, and they tend to gloss over things which they don't want Westerners to see. And so right now they're checking other
We're looking at 10 translations. The only one that's translated other than by the star is Khalifa, who's a heretic. Muslims recognize as a heretic, and he says, as the stars fell away.
As the stars fell away. He doesn't understand it to mean wa. I mean, and. He didn't understand the conjunction wa to mean and, as the stars fell away. And in the context, as the stars fall away, why are you saying as the stars? He's appealing to them as witness. Surely as the stars fall, so is Muhammad true.
Yeah.
And by the way, if you want to check out various translations of the Quran in English, go to www.QuranBrowser.com. QuranBrowser.com. When you spell Quran, you have to spell it Q-U-R-A-N, not K-O-R. Q-U-R-A-N, browser.com. There you have various English translations of the Quran and an Arabic transliteration available for free, so you can check that out.
Isn't it interesting that typical Muslim, and the argument offered by the Quran for how you know it's the word of God is it's amazing literary excellence, and Muslims can't even agree on how to translate this.
Yeah.
They call in and try to give it all kinds of different translations, and to say it means an, or it means as, or it means by.
Yeah.
What do you do with this? You can't translate the first line of a surah without coming up with all kinds of different translations.
Well, and they need to read the Muqaddimah by Ibn Khaldun, one of the greatest supposedly Islamic historians, who said that anyone who says that the language, this is a Muslim historian that was well respected, anyone who says that the language of the Sahaba, the companions of Muhammad, was some great Arabic language that should deserve some peculiar exceptions because that language was somehow heavenly Arabic is basically wrong. I'm paraphrasing what he said. He said, as a matter of fact, these fellows didn't know Arabic that well. Their language was not well developed, and there were many errors in their language. And as a matter of fact, even Uthman, the third caliph, when he saw the Quran that Zayd ibn Thabit had written and comprised, right, did he not tell them, well, okay, but this has errors in it? Mm-hmm. Even Uthman, who ordered the recension of the Quran, the third caliph, after he saw that which we have today, supposedly, according to Muslims, we have the same Quran. Well, you know, if you agree with the fact that Uthman did have the recension, and Uthman said there's errors in that. And they keep telling us the miracle is in the language. What is the miracle in the language? I'm learning Arabic. There's all kind of Jews, Israeli spies learn Arabic. Is it a miracle? I mean, what's going on?
They don't know either. They're just taught to say that. That's what they're taught. Oh, it's a miracle. It's a miracle. It's a miracle. And if you don't like to think about what's presented to you, you just go on repeating that, and you end up at the end of the day saying it's just a miracle. It's just a miracle. It's miraculous. Well, what is it that makes it miraculous? I don't know. It's just a miracle. Well, what about it is miraculous? That's just a miracle. You can say that about anything, my friends. I can give you anything. I can say that Dr. Seuss is a miracle.
Yeah.
I can say that the Cat in the Hat is a miracle. Look how easy it is to memorize.
Did you know there's a miracle on 34th Street?
Yes,
there
indeed.
There in New York. You need to go
right
check
there.
That
I'm
out.
I'm going to head down there.
That's a great film, by the way. The original black and white version from 1947. That's the best. Anyways, okay, I've got them stumped. Let's go to the next caller right now. Welcome, you're on the air with Jesus or Muhammad. Hello, you're on the air. Jesus or Muhammad, you're on the air.
Hello?
Yes,
hello.
Welcome to our program.
Yes, there are many, many things to be said here, but I don't know if we have enough time.
Okay, can you please address the topic of the satanic verses?
I was not prepared for that issue. I do not know enough about it.
But that's the subject of the program, and no Muslim has been able to address it. Why is that?
Well, I'm sure there are a lot of Muslims ready to address that.
We're waiting, but go ahead with your point. We're waiting, but go ahead with your point.
Yes, exactly. Let's go along with my point. First thing to be stated, I'm not a scholar in the matter, but I just want to ask, when I want to learn about Christianity, I ask the Christians. When I want to learn about Islam, I ask the Muslims. The Muslim scholars, I don't ask you about Islam.
Do you ask Ibn Kathir? Hold on, can I ask you something? Would you consult Ibn Kathir, Al-Tabari, Ibn Ishaq, Ibn Ishab, Ibn Hisham, Al-Qurtubi, Al-Bukhari,
yes.
Imam Muslim? These are all the scholars that we are referencing and we learn the Islam from.
Yeah, and it's very important. We don't say, hey, Muhammad delivered the satanic verses because we say so. That's not what we say at all. We say, Muhammad delivered the satanic verses, and we know it from these 37 Muslim sources that report Muhammad delivering the satanic verses, and by applying the principles that historians use to investigate history. So we're not saying, hey, believe in what we say about Islam. We are saying, believe in what anyone could arrive at by careful historical investigation of the Muslim sources.
But David and I spend money to get your best resources, your scholars. We don't buy Christian books on Islam. We buy Muslim books by Muslim scholars on Islam, and we spend our own money to do so. So we're learning Islam from your scholars. You're rejecting it.
But go ahead.
Yeah, I'm sure your listeners are aware of your position. I'm just trying to let you be aware of mine.
Okay, go ahead.
As for that part, is that what I can tell you is that you go to the scholars because sometimes you have to read certain things within certain contexts. Now, the scholars are the ones who could tell you about that, but I'm not calling in regards to asking you about Islam.
Okay, go ahead, sir, and give us your point quickly, please.
All right. This one is for Shamoon. I have a few questions. Tolerate as long as you can. For Shamoon, first of all, I saw a debate. He was debating Qureshi.
Yes.
And he brought up the case of Daniel 7, verse of Daniel 7.
Exactly.
He's saying that it was Trinitarian in nature.
No, that's not what I said. I said that it shows that there are two divine persons, which comports with Trinitarianism. That passage is actually affirmative of binitarianism.
Yes, okay. Well, the point is that you alluded that there are multiple beings in the Godhead.
Multiple persons.
Multiple persons.
Persons,
and
one being.
You use verse 13 where you said, and you use the last part of verse 13, sorry, the first verse 13 where you said, there was one like the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven.
Exactly.
And you said he was given authority, glory, and sovereign power. Mm-hmm. But Quraysh seems stunned by this, but as long as you keep reading, verse 15, it says that Daniel, the person who had the vision, asked somebody to interpret it for him, and that, you know, if you read it, verse 18 says, but the science of the Most High will keep the kingdom and possess it forever.
Yeah.
Now, this in no sense means that the saints are part of God.
Okay, can I now address you? Because I know you're going to go verse 18. You didn't hear me. I even said you're going to go to 18. Actually, no, you're distorting the context. Because the Son of Man represents the saints of the Most High in that when he rules on their behalf. They're not one and the same entity. Do you know how you know they're not one and the same entity? Because in verse 14 it says, all nations will serve or worship the Son of Man, which would actually be a violation of the pure worship given to God if this refers to the saints of the Most High. I'm aware of verse 18. Actually, you're assuming that because the saints will receive the kingdom, this somehow conflicts with the Son of Man being a reference to a single individual. You're wrong, because the Son of Man is ruling on behalf of the saints whom he represents, and that perfectly comports with the New Testament, because when Jesus ascended to the right hand of God the Father and sits enthroned,